Okay, so good day everyone. My name is Evgeny, and I will talk with you a bit about MCMC. You have today and during the whole school very sophisticated and beautiful lectures about probabilistic numerics, and the working horse of the probabilistic numerics is the sampling scheme, and one of the most powerful sampling scheme is MCMC. So during our tutorial, we will step by step from very simple methods go to the, I could say it, complicated method as Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, and I hope you all will get intuition how the sampling method works, and you will use it further in your work, and you will more understand how to sample from posterior distribution, which is an essential step for probabilistic numerics. So please open your notebook in Collapse in the folder probabilistic numerics. You can also open with solutions or without, as you prefer. And we will step by step go. So, okay, I assume that all open. Okay, let's briefly say what we will do. So we will start with general framework of Metropolis-Hastings-Merkov chain. Then we will implement and see the behavior of the simple proposals. And then we will finish with HMC proposal. And also for you that fine enough with MCMC already, there are some auxiliary problems. You can think about it if you are boring with the seminar, but we will not cover them during the tutorial. So, okay, what is sampling in the nutshell? We have some energy function that define our target density distribution, and we want to take an expectation with respect to this distribution. However, this distribution is very complex, and we cannot easily sample from it, or even we have not distribution in the whole, we have only energy function. So we need somehow to obtain the sampler, and then we can take expectation by averaging over the samples. So there are plenty of approaches, but most common, and as I probably can say most powerful, is Markov chain Monte Carlo. So what we need to do to obtain our sampler? So we firstly need to construct a Markov chain, and the essential what we need from this chain is that just 2 points. Firstly, it should be easily to sample from it, and possibly cheap, because for complicated functions and high dimensional spaces we need to obtain a lot of samples. And that the stationary distribution of our chain is our target distribution. And so as we call it Markov chain, we define the chain by some transitional operator. So you can think about it as conditional density, or in discrete case it's just matrix, or something else, as in Hamiltonian Monte Carlo it's a deterministic proposal. But the essential thing that it's take 2 points. It's take the point in which we stay and produce sample of state that which we can transit from our current state. Okay, and it, here it's a bit more formal, but the intuition is straightforward. So what does it mean that we have the stationary distribution as our target? So it just means that if we have sample from our target distribution and we perform the transition from this point with our kernel, we again obtain sample from our stationary distribution. However, you can see that this condition is in integral form, and it's very complex to introduce such methods that we can construct such kernels that will be directly satisfy this condition. So instead of this, we will push a more strict condition, but despite that it's more strict and more powerful, it's more easy to construct Markov chains that satisfy it. And so this, such a condition called this detailed balance, or as I more prefer, it's reversibility, and in it could be written as here. Okay, and easy to see that if the our operator P satisfies this equation, that fixed point equation holds true. You just should to sum or integrate what you more prefer the left part. That's we see. Then we under integration sign we should use our detailed balance condition, and as we done it, we obtain that the distribution of new point is also target, and this one is just a conditional probability, so it's integrated to one, and so we are done. Okay. So in the inspired by this simple condition, it was to introduce Metropolis-Hastig algorithm. So it looks maybe a bit scary, but in a nutshell it's very simple. So we in each point we generate a proposal, and then we have two possibilities. The first possibility is to accept our proposal and go to new state, and this is this one. And other possibility is to reject it, and hence we stay in the current state. Okay, and you can just think about this transitional density as a mixture of two possible transitional densities, where Q is our proposal and alpha is our test. That say for us that we should reject with some probability alpha or accept the point. So as we write our transitional kernel in this in the following form, we should remember that we have detailed balance condition. And we want that the kernel in such form to satisfy it. And what we can control and modify to satisfy our detailed balance condition. So with Q we have not so much freedom, because we should choose such Q that we easily to sample from it. And this is mostly our priorities, that it should be easily and efficiently sampled from Q. So we have freedom, and it's very much freedom on this how to shoot the test of rejection or acceptance point, that the detailed balance is held, and then we have our target distribution as we desired. So we just apply this guy to the detailed balance and obtain the following equation. And by this denoting, such of you that familiar with important sampling can get some intuition, and this is just as important twice between two distributions. One distribution is forward, when we from current point from our target obtain our transition operator, and the denominator is a backward distribution, when we stay in some point and obtain operator to this. And this ratio is exactly what we should to rewrite to obtain detailed balance condition. So we have such equation, and we could a bit play with it to see what possible tests we can get. So let's start from easy thing. We just add to both sides our test, and then just multiply by this guy, and obtain that our test should be like that. And it's true for any acceptance test for Metropolis-Hastig that it should be look like this. So we have any function s that is symmetric, and in the in denominator just 1 plus our ratio of densities. Okay, also we can easily see this condition. And this is two most common acceptance tests in the Metropolis-Hastig is these two guys. So if you put S just as one, we obtain the Barker test. This one, and if we a bit play with more play with this guy, we obtain the common Metropoli-Huskins test. So, and as you see that from proposition 2, the Metropoli-Huskins test has the most acceptance rate from the whole tests. And for me, it just, I suppose it's a bit surprising that there are different tests with different probability of acceptance, but all of them produce the samples from the target distribution. And as Metropoli's test is the most, let's call it acceptable, so in the sense that it's accept with the most probability, it's the common, most common to use. But in some cases where it is noise in your observations or in the estimation of the density, it's preferable to use this one because it's more robust. But the price for this is, of course, that you have low acceptance rate that you will need to spend more computational budget. Okay, let's summarize. Any questions so far from this side? All trivial, all nonsense. I speak that you cannot understand. Okay. Okay, so let's a bit summarize one more time. Just we have our propositional kernel Q, we sample from it, and then we decide accept or reject. And we have this guy's tests. But please note that almost we will work on the log densities and not with densities. It's just technical detail, and you will see it on the code. And also, as I wrote here, you can see that Q is density, but it's just convention. It could have no density, for example, say in ChimC. Okay. But as this is tutorial, so we need to see how to implement this all. And we want to implement it a bit abstract. So as we want to generate proposals different and sample from them. So as a basic class, we need to sample from the multivariate normal. And we should to sample from it. We should to estimate the energy of this distribution. And for some cases, we need to also estimate logarithm of PDF with the normalization constant. But mostly it's enough to estimate the energy. So okay, we will use this guy a lot. It take a batch of points, batch of means, and the Halevsky factor of the covariance matrix, and produce what we want from it. Okay. And also we need to implement the class that I call target. So from target, we want to just be possible to estimate the energy. And for some more advanced proposals, we also need to take the gradient of the energy. So we will take the gradient thanks to PyTorch easily, and the energy term you will need to implement. And this is just some stuff to plot the contour and so on. Okay, and the last, and maybe the main two classes is, the first is proposal class. So we need, what we need from proposal, we need to implement the transition. We take the batch of points in the, as the current state, and we produce somehow the, our proposals. And we also need to estimate the energy of these proposals. Okay, and here is summarized, yep. The what is MASH sampler, and it's always look like this, despite what the target on the proposal. So we need to estimate log acceptance probability and just compare it with the logarithm of sample from uniform. And then we also need to make transition from our state, and we need to do it in the cycle. Okay. And also we will save some statistics from our chain to get some intuition what proposals are good and what proposals are bad. So we mostly interesting in acceptance rate. So as much we when we accept a lot, we good, but not always, because we can accept points that are highly correlated. And to distinct these two possible outcomes, that we accept different points and have high acceptance rate, or the case when we accept nearly the same points, and because of this we have acceptance rate, we also will count the yeses. It's called as effective sample size, and so you can think this about it, that how many samples you will really have that have the same variance, and then from your whole chain. Oh, because the correlation between samples increase the variance. It's quite straightforward. Okay, and this is this is our three two examples from which we will be working. So let's take a look on them. Okay, this is guy's Pico, so you can see that it has very ill condition and covariance matrix. This guy is Banana, you can see that it's just a bit squeezed Gaussian distribution on the tails, and because of that it has a heavy tails with a bit complex geometric, and this is just a mixture of three Gaussians. Okay, and let's start with very simple proposal. The most simple that SMOD B can be, it's a just independent proposal that is sample points from the normal distribution with no dependence on the our current state. Okay, let's a bit look how we implement that class. We take Halevsky factor, we take the mu, the mean, and what we return? We return the batch of samples from this distribution, and also we ask for energy from this batch. And the ratio of energy is implemented above in the proposal class. So, okay, let's see in different cases what we obtain. We introduce a very high variance of our covariance matrix in the kernel. So we obtain quite different samples, but you can see that our effective sample size and acceptance rates are low, just because we know nothing about our target distribution. We just put points on the plane and see what is OK and what is not. And because of that, we stay in one in the same plane slot and have very bad acceptance rate. We can play with it a bit. Okay, and you can see that if we decrease variance of our proposal, we will perform much better. We have high acceptance rate, we have some diversity of points, but because it's two example, you can see that we have very bad mixing of our chain because we stay in the same region, and we're not satisfied with that because we maybe wanted to take expectation such functions that have high values on the tails, for example, and low values on the middle of our distribution, and then we mostly generate nothing. Okay, we can change mean of our proposal, and now we see that we generate same picture, but in the different region of our target distribution. So in this and this put a very simple thought to do is to introduce the Markovian structure on our proposal. So we can sample a bit here, a bit there, and perform a random poke. So and such proposal has this name, Rendezvous. We just stay in some point, sample around it with a curve defined by our covariance matrix, and go or not go to this. And in such manner we travel our space. Okay, so please implement the transition and the energy of such proposal, and we will see how it works. Okay, I suppose in 5 minutes it will be okay. Maybe less. Okay, I suppose you done because it's mostly the same as independent. You just need to change the mean. Okay. Let's obtain some intuition from pictures that we get. We see that we a bit nicely cover the support of our distribution, but also you can know that the samples are highly correlated. And you can easily see it from the projection of the coordinates, and also you see that the points are clustered together. So, and because of that, we have the very low effective sample size. So we sample 100 points and have the same result as that we sample 6 or 5. It's not very good. So. Can we do something that could help us to solve this problem? And the answer is yes. And so we need to somehow introduce the, our knowledge of the geometry of the, our target distribution to our proposal. And for such simple distribution, it's very easy. We just need to okay, we will cheat a bit because we already know the covariance matrix. But okay, for unimodal distribution, we could estimate the Hessian. And so we take this matrix and put it to the as covariance matrix of our proposal. And let's see what we have now. And you can see that we have very more nicely behavior because our proposal now informs about the geometry of the our target distribution. And it's going across its offer. So, okay, what's the highlighted of this story that it's, I not advise you to use a rendezvous proposal because in the dimensions that higher than 10, it will kill you. But I just want you to show that the, using the knowledge of the geometry of your target distribution, it's a very good thing. And if you somehow have some knowledge, you should use it in that proposal that you construct. Okay, so also we see that using the derivatives of the distribution is a good thing. Let's do something with the gradient. And it's also quite a simple idea that we want to sample from such places where the density function or probability is higher than in the current state. And it's, let's do that we always do in optimization. Let's perform the gradient step to generate the proposal. And okay. And so such proposal called this just Langevin. And we will see that it's just the particular case of HMC when we perform one step. But for now, you can see that just we make a gradient step and then we add a bit noise from it. And okay, also please write in transition and the energy stuff here. It's mostly the same. You also need to use only one new thing, that ask from your target to get the gradient of the energy. That's all. So okay, let's discuss what we obtain. So we see that we have a okay acceptance rate, but we also see that we have the most samples concentrated near the mode of the distribution. And okay, it's not a surprise because we use the gradient steps. Okay, let's a bit decrease the size of our step, and you can see from the projections of the coordinate that this starts to behave like a random walk, and it's also not a surprise because okay, we reduce the vector of our gradient two direction. Yep.
Two things. Could you please talk a little bit louder? Just a little bit.
Maybe.
And sorry for interrupting, but it's just a kind of.
So after the tutorial, we still we got like around 30 those MLSS t-shirts, around 20 middle and around 10 S. And so you are welcome to grab it. Who needs? Okay.
Okay. Okay, but let's look on the other more complex example, where we have several modes, and we can see that we have the same problems as with the random walk proposal, and it's again common case for Langevin dynamics, and well, it's not rigorous statement, but I can say that if you need to use for large-scale problem the stochastic version of MCMC, then you need to use Langevin, because you can get stochastic gradient and so on. But if your problem is large in scale of dimensions, but not in scale of the as common in machine learning of data points, you should avoid the Langevin, because it's in high dimensional, it's mostly like random walk. But once again, from these simple examples, we get intuition that, okay, making gradient steps is good, but making one gradient step is not enough. So we need something more. We need to discover such proposal in which we making several gradient steps, but making it somehow to conserve our energy between points, to not to stuck on the mode. And okay, that's there is one of it. It's called HMC. There are plenty of modifications of HMC, and well, mostly all modifications work in two directions. One direction is to how to introduce more geometry notion about our target into proposal, and the second direction is how to avoid random walk behavior of our proposal, because we are a bit killing ourselves when we are making proposals that satisfy the detailed balance, because satisfying the detailed balance is mostly, it's very similar to have random walk behavior, and we should to be no, maybe not we, but people who construct new methods should work very rigorously to make such proposals that satisfy detail balance, but in the same way they have very little random walk behavior. Okay, so what we do? No, firstly, we will introduce some auxiliary variable and say, okay, we now want to sample not from our target distribution, but of such distribution, margin of which is our target distribution. And okay, we just say it. And then when we sample from some such distribution, we can just take all x and say that this is our samples. Then we need to satisfy the conditional distribution, and we also can say, okay, let it be normal distribution. And as we obtain some intuition from the example with Langevin, with random walk, where we use S covariance matrix Hessian, we will say, okay, let's our such distribution will be, its covariance will depend over our x state, and our intuition is the same as the example with random walk. And then we can thought, okay, we accept point if the energy between our current state and the proposal state is mostly the same. So we need to generate proposals in such way that the energy level is mostly the same. And we can open book with physics and see, okay, Hamiltonian dynamic is guaranteeing them such proposals. And then we just take logarithm of our distributions and see, well, this is nas, this is our Hamiltonian, and this is our the system that generate our dynamics and will generate our proposals. But you can see that things are looking scary, and it's mostly because of that we introduced that our moment PU is depends, its covariance matrix is depends on the our state x. As we done that, we have that it's not more separable because you have here x and p, and you have very complex system. But it's have a pros and cons. So the pros is very simple. We will take into account the geometry of the our target distribution, and hence we will have high acceptance rate, high ESS, and it's good. But there is trade-off. So we, as we have high acceptance rates and different points, we will need to generate less points. But in same way, we need to spend more budget on the computing the derivatives. And what is more complex now to simulate from such dynamics, we need to perform the implicit numeric scheme. And hence, it just we need to perform several gradient updates and to obtain sample from solving our numeric scheme by fixed point equations. So to avoid that, we say, okay, let's make things a bit clearly. Let's our momentum is be just Gaussian. And then we have simple dynamics and simple acceptance test. Also, even for such simple dynamics, we cannot integrate analytically. So we need to use some common integration, numeric integration scheme Euler or Verlet. And okay, let's somehow choose between them, and let's just take a look on a simple example from this simple way, and then we just will decide without any keywords. So what we see here, the red ellipse is a true trajectory in the first row, in the second row it's the value of the Hamiltonian during our dynamics. And dynamics is the blue dots. So we fix the step size and compare methods. So when we perform the Euler integration, you can see that we're going far away from our true dynamics, and okay, Hamiltonian value of Hamiltonian changed dramatically, it's grow exponentially, and okay, we can conclude that our test of acceptance points is comparing values of the Hamiltonian, that we should avoid such behavior, and then we should avoid the integration by Euler scheme, because we will always reject points. Then we say on Verlet and see that the value of the Hamiltonian is staying mostly constant, and it's very nice. What this means? We will accept every proposition mostly that we will obtain from such numeric integration. And also we can wonder how this method is sensitive to the growing the step size, and if we growing it a lot in such simple case, that we see that okay, maybe it's now it's not look like our target trajectories, but what is more important for us, because you know that it's not lying on the real trajectory, it's not the problem, because we can always fix it, because we apply Metropolis-Hastings correction, and we just need to that we should to accept points regularly. And we see that okay, the value of Hamiltonian is fluctuate, but not very much, so the acceptance rate will be reasonable, and we're okay with such case too, and maybe we even more okay with such case than with that, because with okay, we will accept here more rare, but with a bigger step size, we will produce more different points. Okay, and also it's, some nice properties of the leapfrog integration, so it's volume preserving. It could be reversible just with flipping the moment and so on, but I suppose you will know it. Okay, and one more comment that you see that we here consider Verlet integration scheme. It's only second order, and you can wonder, okay, if we want to preserve our Hamiltonian value, why we not to use higher order integration scheme? And the answer is simple, because it's once again it's trade-off, and consider that you use a higher order integration scheme, and you will spend a clock wall time on it more, even if you accept more often than with Verlet. But in Verlet, in clock wall time, you can just do more steps while you perform this one. So because of that, it's Verlet more common. But in some cases, there are papers they use high order two. And okay, as all time before, I ask you to write the transition step, and maybe something else. No, only a transition step. And please note that it's as I see in some tutorials, as it's a bit misunderstanding that we should do leapfrog always. Let's do L time leapfrog. It's one time leapfrog, then second time leapfrog, and third time leapfrog, and so on. But it's you can see that the end of leapfrog step and the start of leapfrog step is the same for momentum. So you need to do leapfrog, then several earlier iteration, and then just once again make half step for momentum, and that's all. One more thing. So you also can a bit modify the algorithm very easily. You can select the number of steps not deterministically, but just by sampling it from the by uniform distribution from one to some that you prefer maximally, and it will always help you, because from the two example, you can see that when we perform much integration steps, we can just a bit start to look volkiness on a circle. So we can go back to the point when we start, and it will be a pity, because we to perform such trajectory, we will waste a lot of computational budget to estimate the gradient of our target distribution at each point of the trajectory, and it's always costly. So to avoid this, we should tune it a bit, and also we can shoot it, make a bit randomizing to select it randomly. Okay, I suppose you all copy paste to write simple lines. Let's look in our trajectories. And you can see that it's, let's make other run. Okay, it's one small satisfactory. So you can see that we traverse along our distribution more, and this is first row is the one trajectory, and in the second there are all that we done in parallel. So it's our target. It's the coordinates of the momentum, and this is the value of the Hamiltonian during the trajectory. So we see that it's mostly staying the same, and because of that, okay, we have a higher acceptance rate. But you can see that we also make have not so big effective sample size. It's because, as I said, we can traverse from so long trajectory and stay back close to the our starting point. And that's a common problem for the HMC. That it's very sensible to the number of steps and to the size of steps, and there are plenty advanced methods that somehow solve this problem. And also, as we discussed when I introduced it a bit briefly HMC, that using the not just Gaussian momentum, but the where we, our covariance matrix of momentum depends on the state x, it will be make it more sensible to the hyperparameters L and epsilon. But we have one more example. It's very simple. We will again sample from our squeezed Pickle distribution, but we will see that how the selection of the step size is, even for such a simple case, affects for results drastically. So please insert your code and we will see results. Okay, suppose all are done. So let's discuss results. So when we start with not very big step size, we see, okay, it's acceptable results. But when we a bit increase it for such magic step size, you see that we have a blob. Our Hamiltonian begin to grow exponentially, and we have divergence here. So and in such simple cases, easy to find this magic number, because it's just a minimal eigenvalue of the matrix that from our numeric integration scheme, and for 2 na 2 and such simple Gaussian potential, we can easily get it. But what was the point of such illustration, that even as in many tutorials you can see that the wavelet integrator is stable, the row is bounded, and so on. For even for such easy case, you can find the, such step size that when you, if you even a bit higher than the critical value that distinguish the real and the imaginary eigenvalues of our numeric procedure, you will obtain the blob of your sampler. So because of that, it's usually people perform burn-in period. Then when they fixed the size of the number of leapfrog steps for some number, usually it's quite big, about 20, maybe more, and then they trying to change the step size to keep acceptance rate in the feasible level, like 60 or 70%, something like that. In some cases it would be even more. For example, in log, when your energy is log concave, it you can get about, I don't remember exactly, but near 90% acceptance rate, it will be okay. But for more complex distribution, it's recommended to keep it as 60%. So that's it. That's the time is also finished. So if you have questions, okay, please know. So I suppose you just, if you have questions, you can just come to me and ask something, or go other places.